Our next speaker will be Edmundo de la Vega, speaking on the Inca Road from Titicaca Basin to Contisuyu. Professor de la Vega is associated with the Universidad Nacional del Altiplano de Perú. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to thank the Smithsonian Institution, especially Dr. Ramiro Matos and all of his working team for organizing this symposium and the excellent exhibition on the Inca Road that is presented by the National Museum of the American Indian. I also want to thank the organizers for your kind invitation to participate in this event. And it is a great honor to be here with you. Before beginning my talk, I want to just clarify one thing. Unlike my colleagues that came before me, my talk will not be so academic or rigorous. On the contrary, it will have a more general structure and informative, and is oriented to a less specialized public, but I hope you will be interested as in any case. The Kapaknyan, or the Great Road, is a physical expression of the political project of unification of the Inca state, a project that from Cusco, the capital of the empire, sought to integrate and articulate both in social, political, and economic, cultural, and ideological terms the populations and territories of the four regions in which the Tawantinsuyu is divided. This project has gone throughout time and has achieved the fact that governments and teams from six countries have worked together, and UNESCO has declared Kapaknyan as a World Heritage Site. But also, it has led to Kapaknyan being perceived as a system of longitudinal roads, north-south, that leave the Haukaupata Plaza in Cusca towards Chinchasuya north, Antisuya to the east, Coyasuya to the south, and Contisuya to the west. However, while this perception is true, it's not complete. Because when you look at it in an integrated fashion, in addition to the longitudinal stretches of the highlands and the coasts that link Ecuador and Colombia in the north and Chile and Argentina in the south, we need to add also the east-west stretches that go from the ocean across the mountains down to the Amazon area. Both archaeological research as well as projects for patrimonial management have made progress in this perspective, in this sense, because we're now recognizing the cases of the road between Pachamac and Sauca. In the macro region of Peru, projects by the Ministry of Culture and pioneering research from North American Peruvian archaeologists have documented the complex network of roads that brought together the highlands and Titicaca with the inter-Andean valleys, the coastal route of Arequipa, Moquegua, and Tacna, just to mention the projects in Peru, because in Chile and Argentina, there's also been great progress made in this area. In sum, the representation of two of the largest longitudinal stretches must in addition to the two largest longitudinal stretches, we must add the image of a complex complex network of roads and pathways and traces that linked in regional terms and local terms hundreds and thousands of people who lived in big cities all the way down to the small houses of the farmers and the shepherds. In this presentation, I want to talk about these smaller sections of the road. I'm talking about the road that united, that brought together Collasuyo with Contisuyu, but specifically the area between the Lake Titicaca watershed, the northern highlands, and the region of Arequipa. The geography is very complex in that area. There's a huge altitudinal differences from the Pacific coast to the edges of Lake Titicaca. There's an average distance of 250 kilometers, about 155 miles. There is also an altitudinal change from 0 meters above sea levels up all the way to 6,000 meters above sea level, about 19,000 feet up to the mountain range of Ambato. And it goes all the way down to about 12,000 feet at the edges of Titicaca. So this zone is located in the heart of the Andes, where parallel chains of great mountains and volcanoes run in a north-south direction. Many of these mountains had and still have a sacred characteristic as a place of origin and a dwelling place of the gods. For example, Hualcahualca was the Pacarina, or the place of origin of the Kuntis, a nation whose importance gave rise to the name of a whole region called Contisuyu. In hydrographical terms, this region has a confluence of three primary watersheds of South America. You have the watershed of the Amazon, with more than 7,000 kilometers long, including the Apurimac River, with a tributary that originates in the melting place of the Mismi glaciers. Towards the Pacific, you have rivers like Oconia, Camana, that empty into the Pacific, the Camana. And there you have the canyons of Cotahuasi and Colca that reach depths more than 3,200 meters deep, about 10,000 feet deep, which makes them among the deepest canyons of the world. Further south, the Tambo River is one of the major natural corridors that link the highlands with the maritime coast. And finally, you have the watershed of Lake Titicaca, where, according to Indian legends, the Sun and the Sun's dynasty originated. This geography, which is so varied, gave rise also to a diversity of productive spaces, which go up from the seacoast up to the peaks of the Andes and then go back down again to the Amazon, offering a great variety along the way, a great variety of environments, resources, and raw materials that the Andean societies were able to convert into products and wealth. And they circulated these objects in the region, but also extended throughout all of the Andes with great caravans over the centuries that began to demarcate the routes of traffic and trade along the Capagnan Inca Road. Towards the end of the 15th century and throughout the 16th century, the Incas conquered this immense territory, and diverse ethnic and linguistic groups were already living in these lands for thousands of years. It's to say that in this region, as in all of the Andes, the Incas were the epilogue and the synthesis of a millenary history. So, to understand the relationships between Collasuyo and Contisuyo, we must see them within a very broad time perspective. The archaeological research in the last few years have gone little by little, gaining greater precision in terms of the process of occupation and population of this region. The studies in the Paleo-Indian coast, like Hawaii and Arequipa, El Anillo and Tacuay and Moquegua, show very early populations from the Pleistocene, late Pleistocene period, 13,000 years ago, that had already begun successful exploitation of ocean and coastal resources, which allowed them to settle in coastal areas. And so they began a continuous occupation of the coastal valleys, the inter-Andean valleys, and finally the highlands. So the mobility of the first groups of hunter-gatherers was began to see where the productive spaces were and the resources were, but they also began to establish routes of transit and connection between them. An excellent example of this process is the exploitation of the obsidian sources in Arica and Chivay. Now, artifacts made out of obsidian that came from these quarries have been reported as far away as the south of Lake Titicaca. This broad dispersion gives us an idea that very early on, there were already routes of mobility and exchange which were strengthened in later periods. Towards the end of the Archaic period, the domestication of plants and animals in the Andes were already in great advanced states. 5,000 years ago, most of the Andean, most significant Andean crops like corn, sweet potatoes, and beans had already been manipulated genetically for thousands of years. The highlands area near Lake Titicaca is considered one of the places where potatoes, oca, quinoa, and canino was domesticated and grown. But in as important as being able to grow these crops were the ingenious techniques for conserving and transporting these crops. Both potatoes and oca could be dried, for example, and converted into chuño, tunta, or cayo, which prolonged their preservation for months and sometimes years. Quinoa and canoa flour were processed in manually operated stone mills called batanes. All of these products were easily consumed and stored, but more importantly, it made possible their transportation was made possible over long distances. In addition, the domestication of camelids offered not only rapid access and direct access to meat and to wool, but also the llama became the main beast of burden and form of transporting goods in the Andes. Although a single llama cannot carry very much weight, caravans of hundreds of llamas could transport thousands of kilograms of products throughout the Andes. With the impulse of agriculture and grazing, the foundations were set for the formation of complex societies whose elites began to demand the use and exchange of luxury goods, many of them which were made out of materials that were found hundreds of kilometers away. Between 2,500 and 3,400 years ago, the region around the Lake of Titicaca was the center of development of dispersed political entities like Chiripa, Caluya, Silimuco, and others. But without a doubt, one of the most important was Pucará. This last became the greatest expression of the socio-political complexity of the region during this period. From Pucará, its political and ceremonial center, located in the north of the basin, they made their influence be felt through the dispersion of iconographic patterns that showed up in stone in Cusco, in weavings in Ica in northern Chile, and pottery in Arequipa and Moquegua. The monumentality of the place of Pucará is the reflection of a political elite that based their power on an economy that not only produced surplus, but also consolidated circuits of transit and exchange multi-regionally, but were expanded to pan-Andean dimensions with the development of states like Wari and Tiwanaku. During the intermediate period, two great pre-Incan states made their presence felt. In the north, Wari, whose primary political administrative center was in Ayacucho, and they expanded towards the south of Cusco and the coastal valleys towards Moquegua, where the site of Cerro Baul, which you see in the slide, was its most emblematic settlement. On the other side, you had Tiwanaku, which had its center of origin in the south of Titicaca, but whose strategy, socio-political and ideological expansion, led to the establishment of productive enclaves in the valleys of the Pacific and the Amazon with relationships of reciprocity and exchange among the highlands elites and the coastal elites of Atacama in Chile. So with Pucará, but also with Tiwanaku and Wari, the small paths for local and daily use became great roads to move populations, resources, goods, and ideologies. Another important aspect to keep in mind is that the occupation of this region was marked by a certain competition and a clear territorial division, but nevertheless seems to have been resolved peacefully, which is a strong contrast with what happened centuries later, when after the collapse of Wadi and Tiwanaku, there were various fiefdoms, independent rival fiefdoms that emerged, and there were very heavy conflicts and wars. In the highlands, there were a number of different Aymara language groups, people such as the Canas, the Canchis, the Coyas, the Lupacas, the Pacajes, and others, while the Chilques, Mascas, Chumbilivicas, Arunis, Cabanas, Coyaguas, and Kuntis occupied the highlands of Cusco and Arequipa. Two architectonic elements are characteristics of this period. On the one hand, you have the walled cities of the summit called Pucaras or forts, that have walls that are 4 to 5 meters high and long as 15 kilometers that are circumscribed in parallel lines that follow the peaks in parallel lines along the sides of the great peaks. The spatial distribution of these forts suggests that the conflicts came from several directions, possibly because these were wars of looting more than conquest. All of this made the constructions... All of this led to, in order to be able to build those kinds of forts, they had to form alliances of different sizes and different kinds of power. It's probable, then, that these kinds of alliances originated and were strengthened by recognizing common ancestors, whether real or mythical, but whose existence were materialized through the chulpas, the second architectural element, which consists of large funeral towers built out of stone or adobe, either in a circular or quadrangular shape, and the doors were oriented towards sacred directions, either towards the sun, towards the lake, or towards some dwelling place of a divinity of the mountains. These socio-political conditions also had a strong impact on the organization of the roads. In the first place, many of the roads now are being watched from the forts, but more importantly, new routes were created towards these forts, but also those routes that led to the chulperios like Cutimbo and Siyustani and Puno became over time pilgrimage routes to celebrate the ancestors. So we come now to the end of the 15th century, a time in which the Incas began their slow, gradual process of territorial expansion through political alliances or military conquest. So throughout the 16th century, the Incas became one of the largest empires of pre-Hispanic America. Dozens of languages, hundreds of peoples, and thousands of human beings were integrated into a great multinational state that was divided into four regions or suyus. As we mentioned, in Arequipa, the Kuntis gave origin to the Suyu called Contisuyu, while in the highlands, the Coyas named their region Coyasuyu. The management and control of such a vast and varied territory was a great challenge that could only be overcome by learning from the experience and knowledge of the past, but adjusting them to pan-Andean context. And without a doubt, Capañán was one of the primary mechanisms of articulation and political integration. Capañán of the Coyasuyu, as in all roads, came out of Cusco and went to the southeast towards Ayaviri, where it forked into parallel stretches on both sides of Lake Titicaca and came together again on the other side. The cross-cutting roads went towards the west. Now, the roads of Contisuyu also left the Plaza Aucapata, but went towards the southeast, crossing Velille and Santo Tomas, to join up in Iñapata and continue either in the direction of Cotahuasi or towards Colta, and from there towards Arequipa. And finally, it got to the coast, where it joined with the lowland road, which, heading north, arrived in Chinchasuyu. The control and dominion of Coyasuyo was strategic in every aspect. Ideologically, it was the center of the origin of the sun, the primary Inca divinity, but also Maikukapa and Mama Oklo was from there. They were mythical heroes and founders of the empires. In economic terms, the Koyasuya offered enormous quantities of agricultural products, but especially camelids, llamas, that as the chronists of the time said, they were the primary source of wealth of the pre-Hispanic societies geopolitically, also for the access to resources.
Direct access to resources. In this regard, the most emblematic area is Puerto Inca, located in the northern part of Arequipa, a place where from Cusco, where they sent fresh fish to Cusco that arrived there in less than 2 days, even though it was more than 400 kilometers away through mountains. The ocean or Cotamama was also very symbolic. Spanish chronicles narrate how the Haukayepta Plaza had more than 2.5 palms of sand. But the Contisuyu offered to offered a point where the coast and the mountain range merged, but also resources, food, and also access to the mining riches of this area. Comparing the geography of the Koyasuyu and the Contisuyu, the first one is flatter and less complex for transiting through it. But the Contisuyu, in terms of the Contisuyu, the Andean engineering had to face many challenges. We have the famous bridges, hanging bridges, the most famous one being the Kewasaka. However, the impact of these works was such that some of the chronicles said that the population surrendered themselves just by seeing those constructions. Finally, it is true that the Capagnan was a fantastic engineering work that covered more than 600 kilometers throughout very different topography and very challenging too. It's true that since the colony to date, many changes have happened in the means of transportation, but above all, the Capagnan continues to be a symbol of integration, and as such, it reminds us that in spite of our differences, respect and admiration of the peoples and nations will be the base to build our own great road to the future. And this exhibit that we are enjoying in this museum is a tangible proof of this. Thank you.
Well, thanks to Professor de la Vega's disciplined exposition, I will grant you a little break.